Sonic Workshop. And welcome to Sonic Workshop, the series special that looks at the new audio drama with a panel of experts to talk about production, acting, and story. I'm your host, Jack Ward, and tonight we have with me, via Skype, Richard Captain Radio Summers, who has worked as a reviewer for Radio Drama Revival and an audio producer himself with his own shows and through Odyssey Works, and most recently as the head audio producer for Spaceways, starring Biff Straker, an EVP production. Good evening, sir.
Hey there, Jack. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. We also have Matthew McLean and Robert Cudmore from Audio Drama Production Podcast and Yap Audio, creating, among other productions, Aftermath and now up and coming Valenheim, which we're all excited with, along with Steve Schneider. Lads, how are you tonight?
Great stuff. I'm just excited to hear who the experts are. I'm assuming you're introducing them next. So
we're all that there is, I'm afraid. So let's get on with our first show. Our first show in the Sonic Workshop. I was messaged by Jeff Music, and he asked us to have a listen to his long imagined show, Starplot. Let's have a listen to what Jeff has to say about his show.
Hi, Jack and members of the Sonic Society. I'm Jeff Music. I don't have time to get into all the details, but ever since I was a kid, I wanted to create things, whether it was making art or writing stories. Starplot started as a homemade comic book in 1979 when I was in high school, and since it was hand-drawn and colored in three little 70-page notebooks, it got very limited circulation. By the late 80s, a new friend of mine saw it and envisioned it as an animated movie. He also convinced me to get it copyrighted, which I did, but it never was polished enough to publish anywhere, so I set it aside and lived life. And every so often I'd pull it out and try just rewriting the story part over and over and over again. In 2005, when I started interacting with podcasters on their internet forums, the creative sparks flashed again. The next thing I knew, I was moderator at the Bat Free and writing alternate universe sketches for John Bell, and the idea to bring Starplot to life started to form. Not as a movie first, but as an audio drama, because it seemed a lot more doable and within reach. Sometime in 2007, I recorded the whole thing myself, and then I realized parts of it just didn't work in audio only, so I started another rewrite, and by 2009, I had a script and a bunch of podcasting friends volunteering their voices and sending me files. Despite the fact that it took me 6.5 years to finish putting it together, I found the whole process to be an extremely fun, sometimes challenging, learning experience. Now, I know it's not perfect. There are parts even in this go-around that might not have translated as well from comic book visuals into audio, but I think the production quality is decent, and hearing the characters that have been in my head for so long come to life has been such a thrill that I can't wait to see or hear where they go next, if I can just get off my duff and write some more. So that's who I am. My goal was to bring my story to life and share it, and, if enough people like it, to continue so long as it doesn't take me another 36 years to finish the next part.
So Jeff talks about how working with an audio drama was an easier option than trying to produce an animated movie. He took his comic book visuals to audio. So before we get too deeply into the analysis of part one of Starplot, let's have a listen to the first part.
Starplot. In space, it's really important to know where you are. Your destination.
What a stupid place for a billboard. I'll deal with you later. God, I love it. Now what?
Excuse me, sir, but that door is not an entrance.
What are you doing in my house?
Your house? You must be lost. This is the Simon Fizz Museum of the Revolution.
The who? What?
I'm the museum curator. If you have any questions about the exhibit, I'm the one to ask. I happen to know more about Simon Fizz than anyone on this planet.
Exhibit? What exhibit? This is a three-bedroom house. Or it was.
Other than Simon's actual living quarters, there's a holographic exhibit generator room, which seats about 50, and has a documentary runtime of about 45 minutes.
When did you become the expert?
Shortly after the revolution ended.
Ended? It's not over. Just further away.
Who are you, anyway?
What's this? 15 PR? Shouldn't this calendar read 2125?
That's post-revolution, and you didn't answer my question.
Go away for a couple of years and they change everything. How did you become the so-called expert, eh?
I did research, interviewed hundreds of people, and compiled the definitive history of the war.
So what kind of a guy was your Mr. Fizz?
Have you been in cryogenic freeze or something? Simon Fizz was a genius, a great military strategist, and a leader of the people, a real hero.
You obviously never met him personally.
As a matter of fact, I have. But he hasn't been seen on this planet in 15 years.
15 PR. 15 years? No way, I've only been gone for two. That can't be right. Hero, huh? I believe your opinion is distorted, to say the least.
How dare you? Why, who do you think you are?
Me? I'm the luckiest Fizzian that ever lived. I am Simon Fizz.
Oh my God, you are! Simon, it's me, Eleanor. I didn't recognize you with that hat on.
Ellie? Eleanor Roz? Man, it has been a long time.
This is great! It's so good to see you. Where have you been all these years? Why did you leave? I have a million questions. What's it like to be a hero?
All this hero stuff is really making me nervous. I am not a hero, and there's no way it's been 15 years. Would you like to hear the real story?
Real story? What do you mean?
There seem to be some misconceptions about me that must have grown since I left. And I'd really like to clear this thing up.
Please, sit down. Gosh, it's so good to see you.
Thank you. Now, take notes. This is really important. I'm gonna convince you that I'm not the Simon Fizz that you or this planet seem to think I am. What was it, 100 years ago? Well, it started for me back in 2110. As you probably know, I'd been writing anti-space patrol literature for quite some time, so the SPs and I weren't exactly getting along. They'd been unsuccessfully harassing me for about a month when they chose a more permanent solution. Anyway, Smiley Duke was a friend of mine. He was my source inside Space Patrol. He saved my life more than once, you know. We were expecting him any minute. CR.
Yes, sir.
What a stupid place for a billboard. I bet we're 50 miles off course, too. It's no use, CR. This thing may never fly again. I may just have to drive to work tomorrow. Wait a second. Aha! What's this? Ow!
Why do you insist upon retaining this antiquated rattletrap, Simon?
Because it's easy to work on, that's why.
Yes, but you are continually working on it.
It's one of those things you'll never understand, CR. I'm emotionally attached to it, you know? It has its moments. This, unfortunately, is not one of them. You know, if we could get some decent Molotov crystals, this thing would really move.
Synthetic Molotov is available on the open market.
No way. I don't trust that stuff. Too unstable.
Simon, sensors report a craft approaching.
It's probably Smiley. He's supposed to tell me how my last paper went over. There. That should do it. I think.
What was that?
It is an XG-7. They have found you.
An XG-7? What the? A cube? Here, get in, let's go. Come on. There's got to be a better way to make a living than this. Come on, baby, get off the ground.
He is coming around for another bus.
This is going to be a fabulous day, I can tell already. Get it over with.
I just can't get the hang of this troglodyte alphabet. How do they read this stuff anyway? A lone fighter? That's unusual. I wonder what evil is afoot. This looks like a job for a hood. Why, you?
What do I do, CR? I can't outmaneuver him in this.
Sensors show a third party joining pursuit.
Looks like a guy in a blast suit with a jetpack. Is he nuts?
Take that, you dog. Jerk.
So much for our third party.
Just a moment. I am receiving a transmission. It is Smiley, sir. He has just arrived in this sector.
That's great, but his ship's in no better shape. Open a line. Smiley, since when can XG-7s fly in an atmosphere?
Simon, they've destroyed the underground.
What? How?
Hang on, I'm almost in range.
I'm hit. I've lost power.
Damage minimal. Try to restart.
Weapons not available.
Lord help us. Simon, for everything there's a time. This war should have begun long ago. Do you understand? Promise me you'll talk to the people, Simon. The planet needs you. Promise me you'll get them to fight back.
Yes, I promise. Help.
Power available at 64%.
I'll take your word for it. And another thing.
Smiley, I'm going down.
Remember that story I told you?
What? Story? Yeah, but what's that got to do with this?
Everything, Simon. Everything.
What? Smiley, no! You idiot! Why? I just stood there a moment, staring at the flames, smelling the smoke. There was death right in front of me. Smiley had gone to a better place. There was nothing I could do about it.
I have no record of Smiley Duke. What a friend! You must have been devastated.
Not at first. I'd seen so many Space Patrol atrocities, it didn't faze me for a while. I guess I just went into shock. Does this museum resemble my house enough that it has food in it?
Well, yes. As curator, I have to live here, so?
In my room?
Oh no, I'm set up in the basement. It was empty.
I have a basement?
You do now. Actually, it's bigger than the house. Look, if you'd like to change clothes or something, your room is as you left it, more or less. I'll get us some lunch.
What if the museum gets some visitors?
Oh, nobody ever comes here anymore.
Huh? Why, Smiley, why?
Beep.
He was always so full of absurd ideas.
Shall we check on our mysterious third party?
You're so robotic, CR.
I am cognizant of that fact, Simon. But there is nothing we can do here. And I suggest we vacate the area before reinforcements arrive.
So, this is life during wartime. Goodbye, Smiley. Let's go.
Comrade, Space Patrol is our common enemy.
What?
Are you injured?
Hardly. Do either you or your flying trash can have a first aid kit?
I am not a flying trash can.
Sure, in my ship. What kept that thing in the air?
The XG-7. I do not know. The patrol has only recently come up with that one. But as you know, any significantly advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And that is why this planet is at the mercy of the Space Patrol.
Well, thanks for the help.
Yes, I am certain that your hilarious diversions delayed the XG-7's intentions significantly.
You're welcome. It was my pleasure. You see, I'm starting a revolution. Would you like to come?
A 3-man resistance? Against all that? Are you kidding?
But what of the Underground? Aren't you connected with it?
Not anymore. I've just been told. The Underground's been destroyed.
That is most unfortunate, but that makes our struggle all the more necessary. 3 are better than none.
I do have a promise to keep. All right, what do you propose?
Well, until an army can be remobilized, just about all we can do is sabotage and small hit-and-run attacks. I think they call it terrorism, from their point of view.
What do you think, CR?
Do you know this Herorian?
No. Who are you?
I am Herorian, that is true. But we are not all in the patrol. Argon, at your service.
So what's the big red letter Z on your chest for?
Z? This is a Z?
Right. I'm Simon Fizz. The flying trash can is CR-12.
I am not.
I've heard of you. The patrol considers you a joke.
That may be true, but they don't consider you a joke, Mr. Fizz. I have heard all of your work. Revolution is no laughing matter. You have written about it. Are you willing to act?
Well, CR?
The events of today are already quite revolutionary. It has begun, whether we wish to join it or not. In any case, if we wait here one more minute, we will be greeted by another XG-7.
Let's do it.
We need a good ship, but yours will have to do.
Gee, thanks.
We are doomed. This ship is truly a flying trash can.
Shut up and push, CR. Let's get to the mines and see what sort of damage that blaster bolt did.
I'll catch up to you. I want to scan the wreckage for any salvageable components.
Starplot Episode 1 featured the voice talents of Laura Nicole as Max 3.0 and CR-12, Jeff Music as Simon Fizz, Radio U's Nikki as Eleanor Roz, David Avila as Argorn, John Bell as the XG-7 pilot, Radio U's Obadiah as Smiley, and John Steinklauber as Smiley's shipboard computer. Sound effects were by Soundsnap.com, GarageBand, and myself. Incidental music by Kevin MacLeod at Incompetech.com. Theme tune music by J. Harold Moyer, copyright 1969 by Faith and Life Press, Mennonite Publishing House, used with permission. Starplot is released in 2015 under a Creative Commons, Attribution, Non-Commercial, No Derivatives 4.0 International License, based on a work at starplot.net. For further information, see the show notes for websites and details. Thanks for listening. I'm Jeff Music.
So that was the first part of Starplot. I have to say, there are 9 parts to episode 0, and they all pretty much work together in a sequence. So while I'm going to have to play timekeeper here as well as moderator, maybe we can start with some overall thoughts. Robert?
I think it's obviously quite a brave venture, isn't it? Because it's been, as far as I'm aware, adapted from a comic or a graphic novel, and there's obviously a lot going on.
Matt, do you have something to add there for overall thoughts?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, I enjoyed it. It was a very vibrant soundscape, some quirky characters. I was a little overwhelmed with the information. Even I listened to it two times, and I did find myself a little bit confused at times. So if I had to be critical, I would say that possibly in the future, I would try and just drip feed the information out a bit over a longer period. You know, I think a lot of information's been tried to be conveyed in that episode, and it did leave me a little overwhelmed. But that's a very minor criticism, because I'm not just here to say, you know, brilliant job, but I'm assuming it's not the purpose of the exercise. I thought the soundscape was excellent, really vibrant, really rich. Again, if I had to pick up on something there, I would say that maybe a couple of missed opportunities with the scene transitions. I would have liked to have seen maybe just a bit more experimentation when we were cutting from one scene to the next.
Okay, you know, we'll get into all the specifics. We're getting almost into the weeds right now because I want to talk about all of those things. Richard, did you have any quick general thoughts before we get into that?
Well, I have to say I was like less than 10 seconds into it. Well, maybe a little longer than that, when I immediately started thinking of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy with a healthy dollop of Doctor Who.
Oh, okay.
That, for example, Simon Fizz, the main character, reminded me of an amalgamation of Arthur Dent and Ford Prefect with a little bit more manners. But that's what hit me first. So, and I thought it was really fun, but like our other folks here, I got a little bit lost and a little bit of a hurry.
Well, this is where we're going to start. I think we should start with the story. Every good audio drama begins with story, and so that's the plot of it. I think you've got a good point that it's a very rich world. I think we all agree upon that. And in that way, it's almost important to try to let people in slowly. Do you find that's an issue when you're writing Valenhai as well, Robert, that you've got a rich world, you got to be careful about not overloading people with stuff?
Yeah, it's one of the big lessons in radio, and not just radio drama, but any program, documentary, anything that you're writing for radio, or I guess any kind of medium, is you've got to consider what the listener or the consumer already knows, and what they can easily grasp the minute you start talking. So you've got to, it's a fine line, isn't it? It's a balance you've got to strike between giving them something that they're aware of and they can follow, but also give them little clues to leave them wanting more.
Right, because everything happens so quickly. We're introduced automatically to the main character played by Jeff Music, Simon Fizz, as you say, and we don't know an awful lot about him except for he's become extremely famous. So he has a conversation with somebody sort of explaining how some of this has occurred in the background. But it's one of those things that I got a little confused myself between at times. It's like, oh yeah, this is the past he's talking about, and this is present now. What's going on? Did you find that as well, Matthew?
Yeah, well, immediately, if we think about what you want to achieve when you begin a story, when you begin, especially an audio, when you've no visuals, you really need to set the location, I think, quite quickly. And I wasn't sure. In fact, I'm still not sure where it was set. I'm not sure if it was a futuristic version of Earth or a different planet. I would have probably liked to have at least established where we were in the universe. I know by the title that it's some sort of space travel, you know, kind of futuristic story. But I think just maybe in future, just considering, like, you know, do you want the listener to know where they are when you open the story? And I think the rest can kind of flow from that once you've established a base. Is that a fair enough point?
I think it's a fair enough point. I know, Richard, I always struggle when I'm doing Biff Straker, because again, it's also a brand new universe in that way of how much am I going to feed the audience so that I don't lose them as well. Did you get lost with the same kind of situation as Matthew and Robert at times?
Well, with me, it was more being lost in time. After he landed, I got the impression that he was either before or after something had happened, and gradually I got to understand in his conversation with the young woman, Eleanor, who was the museum curator, and the museum turns out to be his home, that it was sort of a post facto thing, and he was bringing her up to date on it. I don't know that that's necessarily a bad thing, but I'm very much with Robert on this, that if you're going to do that kind of confuso talk, and Doctor Who is really guilty of this, but he makes it work. Mm-hmm. Because as Robert said, feeds enough little details in that you can kind of keep up with what's going on. And the wondrous thing about that is that draws the listener in sometimes, if it's executed well, even more than you would with a normal program, even an exciting
one. Right. So other than that, I mean, I was engaged with what was going on in the story. I was interested in learning more. I ended up listening further on to the story as time went by. And I enjoyed, I got a chance to listen to about 3 or 4 episodes before I got caught up with Christmas things. But I'm looking forward to listening to the rest. Did you find as the show went further on past the first episode that this sort of cleared itself up a little more and that things came down on a better pace? Anybody?
Well, I listened to episode 9. No, I think I needed to listen to 1 a second time. I did listen to 1 a second time, but I went from 1 straight to 9 and I found my mind had wandered too much. And so I had to just go back to 1 and listen to that again. Maybe I shouldn't have done that. I should have gone to 1 to 2 to 3. Maybe it's like a soap opera, which is you can't really go back to the beginning because it's been going for decades in a lot of cases. So you just have to stick with it and it'll all become clear. You become familiar with it as you go along. And I suspect that will be the case with this.
I jumped in at 9 afterwards. I think that was a mistake. I think it's unfair to the story to do that because obviously too much has passed in the right. other episodes. And it was just impossible for me to know what was going on. And, you know, that's absolutely no fault of the writer there, because what story can you jump in on episode 9 if you've not listened to the rest? So, yeah, I probably should have went and I listened to half of 2, I think. But then I got home and you know how it is when you pull up outside and you're needing your dinner. But yeah, in hindsight, probably should have listened in a more linear manner. But certainly, you know, my thoughts at the starting point were just that I did feel a bit overwhelmed at times with some of the details, and I'd have been interested to see how that maybe it sort of settled into a bit of a groove as the episodes moved on.
Do you think that anybody for this, it's an interesting thing because we've got people like Bill Hulwig, who is very much visual in the respect that he does artwork as well, as does Matt Leong. Many of these people who do drawing have also done the audio works, and I also find that their audio stuff is extremely visual. It's very moving, it's very fast paced, it's very full. Do you think that people that coming from that visual perspective, do you think that that adds something different to the way you tell stories?
I think this is Captain Radio here. I think that the problem there is that, and Jeff mentioned this in his introduction to us, that he sees so much of the trees that it's difficult to back up and help the person that's listening hear the forest. And he confessed that, and I can easily see why that is. When I first started trying to tell my stories, the vision in my mind was it was going to be up on the silver screen. And gradually over the years, I realized that it would be a lot easier, just as Jeff did, as he said he did, it would be a lot easier to go to audio with some of this stuff. But just as you're listening to a sportscast on the radio versus watching it on television, I know sometimes on the television, the video has gone out, but the audio is still there. And the sportscasters, when they're told, say, oh, I'm going to switch to broadcast mode and tell you what's going on as though we were on the radio. And it does require that they use a different format for describing the sports event and for telling the story.
That's interesting. I find comics, and I've said this before, I think comics are almost the closest thing in medium to radio drama because of the way that you can do a variety of styles, because you can have vignettes done in different ways that you could never do very well in movies or on stage as without it being very experimental. I think there's a real interesting connection between those two mediums. Let's move on to the acting part, because no story can be properly translated into audio without great acting involved. So what are your thoughts on the acting in Star Plot? Let's go with Robert again.
Yeah, there were some good performances in there. I particularly liked the curator. I thought she was very on the scene and very intense, and she gets your attention. The main chap in it is good as well, but if I had any criticism, it would be that he could maybe vary his delivery a bit more. He just seemed to be so amiable no matter what, like, oh, well, here we go, and I see the world's ended. Well, never mind, time for tea. He needs to just be a bit more up and down at different times, although I think that's partly to do with the character as well. you know, that's the way he wants to portray him. But I do feel that he could have a bit more to him, if you like, a bit more depth.
What did you think, Matthew?
Yeah, I've heard a lot worse in terms of performances. It had the obvious issues that, you know, very few audio dramas don't have these issues when you deal with remote actors, purely because, as we all know, they're unable to act together. I'm not an actor by any stretch of the imagination, so I feel like a bit of a bandit even commenting on this. But like I say, I've heard a lot worse. If anything, you know, it's just a case of maybe, I don't know if the cast had worked together long, but I know that over time casts get used to how each other sounds, especially when you're introducing new characters. After a while, when people get scripts through and they start to learn the character they're responding to and exactly how it sounds, and these things tend to improve. But like I say, you know, it certainly wasn't the worst I'd heard, and credit to the people that voiced it.
I would just like to interject as well and say that there's even very famous TV series like, I always go back to Star Trek Next Generation for development. William Riker, the character, was very wooden in the first couple of episodes, and of course after 7 years of practice and development, he's so much more of a 3D character as opposed to the first couple. It could be that kind of thing here where you're still starting out. I mean, even if you look at animated characters like Homer Simpson and Peter Griffin, they're very flimsy compared to what they become when they're a bit more fleshed out over time.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that one of the great benefits of doing a series, and it's also one of the great detriments, is that you wouldn't improve, because then you always want to go back and redo the first couple of episodes, because by the time you get to the end of either season one or series two, that you're going, wow, I finally get what this is about. I get what this character's about. I get what this story's about. So you often say to people, I hear this a lot when people give me something, the Sonic Society, they don't want me to play the first episode of their show. They want me to play something more recent or something halfway down the line, because they feel it's an example of what they can do at this time. Do you find that too, Richard?
Well, I was going to say that in regard to the particular program you just played, I think that Jeff was able to put together a pretty good crew. I know that he was using actors from other podcasting programs that he had done, like John Bell, for instance.
Yeah, and I think, and there's Alexa Chipman there, and yeah, Laura Nicole, and yeah, there's a ton of people.
Absolutely. So in his favor, all of the characters came across fairly comfortable and natural in what they were doing. As was pointed out, there'll be opportunity for them to vary their performances more in the future. But I actually thought, compared to some other first efforts that I've heard, that he displayed a pretty good crew to carry a series forward. Mm-hmm. And I listened to some of the other episodes myself later, and just as Robert pointed out with Riker's character, they were all beginning to even get more comfortable and more loose with their characters. Not bravado loose, but they were becoming like they were getting into their skins a lot better. So I think in this particular case, Jeff is fortunate in that he found a good crew of people to man this, and they jumped right in and started doing what they needed to do.
Yeah, I agree. I find Jeff and I in very similar circumstances when I think of Biff Straker and some other shows that I've done where I've done the acting of the main role. And the problem for that for me is when I'm directing, I can't really act very well at the same time. So I have to do most of my lines outside of other acting. I highly recommend you, if you get a chance, try to get your actors in on Skype so that, and even if you can get two or three of them in to go back and forth, because that kind of immediacy is really hard to fake. I mean, I know a lot of studios who do animation shows, and you can hear in the animated voices, well, these guys recorded these separately, right? So not that it was terrible, but it's just a trained ear starts to pick up the fact that, yeah, these are sort of punched in as opposed to working sort of natively. And I think we all agree, if everybody can be there at the same time, some real magic can happen.
And I think it's worth saying as well to Jeff, like, you're absolutely not alone here. You know, everyone suffers with this problem. Every producers that have been doing it for years are still trying to figure this out. So it's certainly, he's not alone here, is he?
No. I think of you guys coming up with Valenheim, and I'm wondering how that's going to operate with you. Have you planned to do this?
That makes two of us.
Yeah.
And Richard, Robert, you had something to say.
About Valenheim, that we are writing the entire season one before we produce anything, just based on the things we've learned with previous productions and in a lot of what we've discussed tonight, and we're hoping to apply that. And if we can get people together to record at the same time, then that's great. It's probably not going to happen a lot, but that's where direction comes in, I guess.
Well, I was going to say that some of the producers, like Oral Stages and Matt Boudreau, they get everybody on board, and then they take on a recording recording studio and they say, we're going to be here this night and be prepared to stick around and go for as long as it takes to get all the lines cut. And then he, being a really good design and audio engineer, he and his design team take them back and edit and mix them like crazy. So what he does is he arranges for his actors to actually see each other face to face when he's doing it. And that gives you probably the best takes that you can get in terms of the way the characters interact with each other. However, it does mean that there's got to be some kind of geographical nearness to one another to pull that off. And not only he, but others have struggled with this issue of finding some way over the internet of doing those sort of live interaction kinds of things and not being defeated at some point or the other or having to keep repeating lines because of pops and hisses and just total drops in your internet signal while you're trying to do it. And therein is the advantage of doing the single actor remotes, because they can do them alone at home and then send them in, and at least you know that you've got a steady quality to them. It's a big issue, and I wish it could be solved more easily than it has been, but I think we're going to have to wait for technology to catch up on that.
Yeah, you're right.
I was going to say.
When I recorded Borrowed Time, which most of my recordings have been done with sort of local actors here in my apartment, and that's been my real experience, but I tried to do some more satellite actors, and I did that with Borrowed Time, and what I did is have them record locally their own stuff, but talk and go through the acting aspects and the directing aspects to Skype. And that seemed to work pretty well. There was a lot of editing, of course, that's involved with that. I know that when I recorded Biff Straker myself, it took me 5 years before I felt comfortable to be able to do my own role. So hats off to you, Jeff, because it's not an easy thing, as all of you people have been saying.
Yeah, one cheat to that is, or a couple of ways that you can cheat, if you would, a little bit on that, are to get the other actors, say, on the telephone or something, where their voice is not being heard while you're recording. And the two of you can bounce lines off of each other then and do the recording locally. Another way is to find somebody who has some acting ability or the ability to emote the lines the way you imagine that they're going to be from the characters you're going to be talking to. Have them sit across from you and do the lines, and then you respond to the lines and edit them out when you send them in.
How much of the satellite acting have you guys done at Yap Audio? Is it all been at satellite actors, or have you gotten a lot of people in studio too?
I'd say maybe, 85 to 90% of remote cast. And, you know, we try when we can to get, we've got a very, very small group of people, but, you know, we had Caitlin and she's down in London nowadays. We've got a few people, you know, Jim, myself and Robert, and a couple others that we work with. But in general, you know, we like the guys that we've used remotely, and we want to keep using them. We think they're really good. Got a small group of people that we always go to that'll be familiar to anyone who's heard any of our shows. I think having a mixture is good, unless you get a bit of money and are in an area where you can dip in an existing talent pool.
And when you get more working with the same people, they get to know more of what you're looking for in the kind of cadence that you're looking for, the style.
What makes a big difference for us, I think, is having the ability to direct someone there and then, as opposed to getting an entire batch of lines and then saying, could you do it a bit more like this than do another entire batch of lines and so on. Having time to discuss it with them beforehand and then even be there with them and direct them through it, you can make little minute changes to their delivery on the spot. And that for me is a huge difference.
Right. There's other things. Sorry, go ahead, Matt.
Sorry, I was just going to say it's a great feeling when you've recorded an actor and you know that they've nailed all their takes because you were there, and you know that you've got the material, whereas there's always that slight sense of dread when you get remote lines in, even if it's a brilliant actor, because no one's going to get it spot on all the time, and you always know that you're going to have to go back, and you feel like a bad person, basically. Someone's doing all this free work for you and you're getting on at them, but it's just the nature of the beast.
Yeah, and you're a little afraid too, because you don't know when they can get back to record. It might be 10 days from now, you know, by the time they get back to doing it, you never know how busy they are. So it's always a little bit of fear and trepidation when that happens.
And for anybody else that's just listening on the outside sort of here, that's the scourge of volunteerism. It's a blessing to work with a lot of people that are volunteers and willing to give their time and their talent to do it. And many people who may not be able to do things with such talent in other medium do have a chance to work in radio, because nobody can see you. they can just hear you. But you are working with volunteers, and you kind of have to exist in a different world where things just don't happen right when you really wish they would.
Mm-hmm. There was one thing that we've been talking about more and more and using more in audio drama, and that's sort of this sub-vocal or sublingual kind of conversation. So little grunts of understanding, little noises that people have during which add to a more realistic kind of conversation. Do you help people direct them in that way to sort of say, you know, give me some sort of responses so that I know it's not just this ping pong back of dialogue?
I would say that I'm quite an advocate of that kind of thing. We haven't done it terribly much, but there will be certain instances where we'll actually mark it on the script and say, and make sure that you're verbally responding, like, yeah, that sort of thing. Because the one thing about audio drama is that, especially if you don't have them placed in a room and you can hear their echo off a particular type of wall, if they're disembodied heads where one speaks, then there's a little tiny bit of silence, and then the other person speaks, tiny bit of silence, and it goes backwards and forwards. It just feels completely artificial at times. You want a conversation where people are overlapping over each other and the other one saying yeah at the same time as somebody speaking, you know? You really want it to be much more alive than just simply two voices that are very politely talking to each other and stopping to allow the other one to speak.
In the script training that I've received, I would turn in a script for a class assignment or something, and the instructor would say that, for example, in the movie world, they don't want you adding little extra stuff in. Give them the script and let the director and the actor work the rest of it out. So I think that's a good point that was made, that if you're going to add the little grunts and the extra sounds or the acknowledgments and that, you look first to the director to give that kind of instruction to the actors, and then to the actors as they get into their characters, doing the sorts of natural responses that would not be in the script, but that are acceptable for the production.
Mm-hmm. And Tanya Malevich is the queen of this. She does a great job of, when I get notes from back, she has a show that she's editing of mine, a reproduction where I take the role with her. And my acting went up about four times because I just had to try to match her. So she said she was quite scared at some of my takes, which is good. That's what they have to be. But I was quite worried. But she does such a super job. So if you surround yourself with great actors, they just keep pushing you forward as well.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I think that's the same in a lot of fields and different things across the world, is that if you're with other people that have a high standard, then you will raise your standard, even just by learning or the fact that the pressure's on, you know, to play a high game.
Mm-hmm. So speaking of high standards, we're on to production, because once the story is written and recorded, it's in the hands of the audio and engineer to arrange, massage, and layer with effective sound effects and music. So how does Starplot hold up as a produced piece? Let's start with Richard.
Well, I was going to say that I was actually quite impressed with the pacing of it. And that was that I think that Jeff did a good job, and I'm assuming Jeff is the one that did the editing and mixing and design on it, keeping things flowing. He seemed to be pretty much on top of things for the most part. There were a few hesitations in that, but he seemed to keep it going. Where the problem occurred was trying to determine sometimes where the point of view was. Whose spaceship were we in? Who was getting blasted and who was doing the blasting and those types of things. And the other big thing is a natural problem for new producers. Even I am having problems with it still. And that is scattering your characters out a little bit in stereo. Everybody seems to be right in the center channel if you're listening on headphones or something. And it actually helps create depth in your audio if you will have a perspective where the characters are located a little bit off to the left or off to the right or in the center, a little bit distant and so forth. If you can, with Jeff being able to do such good visualization, this should be something that he can pick up well in the future. And that is to see where the characters are and begin to place them with his ears instead of with his eyes as he's doing the editing.
There was a sound effect that I listened to in the first episode. I listened to the first time in the car with my wife, and then I listened to it in headphones later on for my second time. But there was a sound effect that I noticed came out of like the left speaker of the car and then the right speaker of the car. And as far as I knew, it shouldn't have been like that far apart. It should have been placed a little more, you know, center in one way or another, but not literally panned all the way and all the way on either side. I know some sound effects, like they come that way, you know, they come two channeled and they want to give you that kind of feeling of like going across the sort of the soundscape. But it is, like you said, it's important to find a place to place all this in the story. What did you guys come up with, Robert?
Yeah, I know. I just wanted to say as well about panning that it's the first thing that new people to audio drama. It's the first thing they abuse, and I'm severely in that camp that the first couple of episodes, certainly the first episode of Aftermath, I had great fun, but it was far too much. And so it's just one of those things that where a little is a lot, less is more, for sure. The rest of the production itself, though, I did like the sound effects. I liked the soundscapes, and it did help to paint the type of environment. I thought the music was a good choice, because something that's often overlooked is the influence of the music on the listener. And, you know, you really want to choose the right music, because it's really telling people how to feel, how to think, what to expect, the tone. It was kind of funky music, which reminded me a little bit of the mood of Flash Gordon, the film in 1980, you know, because it was really upbeat and flashy, and it clearly wasn't taking itself too seriously. This was a lot of fun, and it's the same with the production here. It was, you know, a little bit of funky music. By no means was it Blade Runner in terms of tone, and that's fine.
Music really does add to the tone and define the tone for a show. This music was done by Kevin MacLeod from Incompetech, which very many people will be aware of who do audio drama and listen to audio drama. And I urge people to listen to Robert Matthews' interview with Kevin MacLeod when they get a chance, if they haven't heard it yet already. It's very fascinating what he does. Matthew, what did you think, since you're very involved in the actual side of the production side of things?
Yeah, well, just to pick up on the comments about the music, I thought, you know, these are, as far as I could tell, a couple of sort of generic garage band music beds, which are kind of looped. Now, I don't think those would have worked well in many audio dramas, but fair play, they made this work. I think it did add something to these soundscapes, and I think it was just the type of story, the type of soundscape, it just worked. And like I say, I don't think it would have worked in many shows. The soundscape was really rich and deep, and I was thoroughly impressed by it. I think it was certainly the strongest aspect of it. Like I said, the only, you know, because I was having to look for faults, basically, it's no good to come on here and just say, you know, everything's great. So with having to look for faults, I think, yeah, in future, probably take the opportunity when you're going from scene to scene just to be a bit creative and, you know, take the listener on a wee journey and make them visualize it a little more than just dropping out of a scene and cutting back. The other thing, and again, who hasn't done this? I thought a couple of the explosions were too loud. We've all done that before, you know, and loudness is a difficult thing to get right. But yeah, it's certainly a pat on the back for the soundscape. It was well executed.
Yeah, I really struggle with loudness because, like you said, a couple of the explosions were sort of a little louder than what I expected. The other thing that I noticed too, because again, if you're looking for picky things, you spend more time focusing on that when you do that. So one of the things I noticed too was that there was sort of, and it's, these are the things that I struggle with, especially because I'm not a very good producer, at full disclosure there. The microphones, there were certain microphones you could tell a different hiss factor going on in there, and trying to get those all to sound like perfect. And it was very minor. Like, it wasn't, some shows you listen to, they're very clearly, you know, totally differently done. There was just that much more effort sometimes in getting all everybody to sound like they're exactly on the same stage is a really challenging thing.
Well, I'm going to do a selfless plug here for Robert and Matthew, because I believe they were the ones that did a show about how to deal with noise reduction. And I would point people to listen to that, because one of the good things that they said had to do with some of that hissing and background stuff. And that is to find something in your soundscape that manages to match those things together. For example, if on one of the recordings there is a little bit of room noise or whatever that's going on, try to find enough of a sample of that room noise that you can create a consistent track for it in the background, and then the rest of the recordings of that can fit inside of that. And from the listener's perspective, it virtually causes all of that sort of hissing or problems in the balance of the recordings to disappear. It was a broadcast y'all did, right?
Yeah, that's right. And actually, the show that I've just released myself, there's, you know, I mentioned Caitlin, who we work with, and she lives down in London. She'd sent her lines up. She recorded them under a duvet on a Zoom recorder, which again, you know, we've all done it. Sometimes the Zooms come with a tremendously high noise floor, and I really had to just pick out a section of silence in her track and make like 3-minute long track with it. And because I had a scene where her character and Robert's character were talking, and I'd recorded everyone else, well, I'd recorded Robert and Jim in my own studio with my own gear and a very, very low noise floor, very silent, and then Caitlin's tracks were cutting in very hissy, so I just used her room tone to mask the whole scene, and it does work. And you know, producers out there can use that technique. It's not a new technique, people have been doing it for years. It's very handy for just masking those louder tracks.
I use room tone just here in my own sort of home studio, where I just make sure I record, like you said, 3-4 minutes of room tone, and that way anybody, there's never that sound of that punch in coming in and out, because they're all on the same part. Robert, you had something?
Yeah, I would say to any actors that if you find that your character, you're looking at the lines that you keep getting and more you're talking over the phone, like from the other end of the phone, or this time your character's in another room, like the bathroom, shouting through, or you're talking from inside a car, maybe it could be that the producer's having to mask the quality of your lines. You might want to ask for some advice, because maybe they just don't want to upset you, because after all, most of us, if not all, are doing this on a voluntary basis, and nobody wants to lose anyone after a productive discussion gone badly.
That's a good point. This is the nicest way of being able to... I always thought Robots of the Company, done by Dream Realm Enterprises, had the best opportunity, because all of their characters were robots, so all the voices is as bad as the microphones could be, it was awesome because it didn't matter, right? So it was a really smart way of dealing with it that way.
When you find yourself always being cast as the boy down the well, that's when it's a good job they're applying reverb to your voice.
That's right. Well, any last comments before we round up? We're almost into an hour already.
I just want to say, like, you know, I hope it doesn't sound like we've been too hard. I think it's a great effort. And obviously, you know, we can talk about the flaws, and we've all got flaws in our shows, but there's no really going back and fixing it now. These are just lessons to learn going forward. So I would say, like, in closing from me, because I've talked about an information overload at times, is sometimes just to, because there's a curse of knowledge that exists, not just in storytelling, but in life. You know, when you get knowledgeable on a subject and you forget that other people don't know what you know, and you begin to talk about it, you begin to convey it. So it's good sometimes just to step back from your story and think, what's the key aim of this episode? Why are the scenes there that are making up, you know, 5 or 6 scenes? What are the purposes of these scenes? What information do I want to get across in each of these scenes? And is that too much information for one episode? And it's just having to think about that. A good thing as well is to get people to listen to your episodes, or even read your script. That'd be even better. Get them to read your script, and someone who's going to give you an honest opinion, and then ask them to read or to tell you what they think happened in that story. And, you know, if something comes up that you maybe haven't clearly explained, you'll find out about it then. And it's better to find out then than before you've recorded and produced a show. But overall, I would say, yeah, a great job. It's a great first series, and the soundscape was really strong for me, and, you know, I wish them all the best with it in the future.
Robert?
Yeah, I don't know if the creator, producer, and the writer are all the same person. I don't know if they've made many things before this, but all of the faults we've talked about here crop up, at least some of them crop up in 99% of all audio dramas at some point. So as a first episode, I think it's pretty damn good. I wonder if it's been heavily influenced by old time radio. I did get that feel on occasion that it had that influence of that kind of relaxed atmosphere and high drama and just a, you know, an entertaining feel, if you like. It's certainly, yeah, I mean, old time radio isn't as big in the UK as I think it is in North America. I nearly said the States there, sorry. But I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's been the transition, and, you know, dare I say it, Star Wars was heavily influenced by things that came many decades before. So it's not about where you've taken something from, it's where you're going with it next.
Absolutely. Richard.
Well, I was going to say to Jeff that he's got a lot of good ingredients for the programs that follow. And I did listen to a few more of the episodes, and he was beginning to work with them a lot better. The complexity of the story arc did continue. So the admonition to look at what you're saying and sort of step back from it and see how it could possibly come across to others is a good one. Read the scripts after you've done them, because I know Jeff is thinking about writing some more of them. Take the those new scripts and just sit down and read them yourself or read them with some friends and that and try to see how it sounds to you. If a line sounds a little plunky, then it will show up in a hurry. If a plot point seems a little bit complex or obscure, that will show up in a hurry too. And of course, your friends are your friends. They're there to help you with it. And your cast is very talented and they are involved in audio drama pretty deeply. So they will give you a lot of lift in that area. Your soundscapes are great. You just need to work probably a little bit more on the balancing of them in the post-production, and you're going to have a future in this medium. I do hope, I know Jeff said he wondered whether he was going to be able to write some more. I do hope he does, and I'm anxious to see what comes out of it.
Yeah, I had a lot of fun with them, and I'm really looking forward to more. So I hope that Jeff continues. I know Jeff's been working with John Bell from Bells and the Bat Free. I think that's where he got a lot of his production sensibilities from, and probably some of his love for the old-time radio as well in that same kind of vein. So yes, just to answer Robert's question, Jeff is the creator, writer, producer, and the star of the show as well. And that's fantastic. And that's a wrap for Sonic Workshop this time around. If you would like to offer your show for the Sonic Workshop, just send us an email at Sonic Society or message us through Twitter, Facebook, or send us your show. We'd love to have a chance to listen in. And I'd like to thank our guests tonight, both Robert Cudmore and Matthew McLean and Richard Summers, Captain Radio. And a special thank you to Jeff Music for the look at your own Sonic treasure, Starplot, tonight. Thanks so much.
Yeah, I just wanted to say thanks to Jeff as well. Because, you know, putting your show forward for something like this isn't easy. And certainly if Robert and I had submitted Aftermath Season 1 for discussion, we'd be here a long, long time talking through all the flaws in that show. So, you know, we're all in this together. We're all trying to learn. We're all trying to improve. And fair play to you for putting it forward and for doing what you're doing.
Until next time in the Sonic Workshop, thanks everyone. I'm Jack Ward saying good night.